1974, I think you know what happened, Pokhran, the Pokhran test took place. I mean, Raja Ramanna and others, they think. It was never followed up. We had a test in 1974. After that, we didn't test at all. Now, you need to have at least 15, 16 tests, frankly. At that point in time, when computers were not as active as it is now, you needed about at least about 15 to 16 tests before you had a really good teacher. Everybody knows that with less than at least about 15, 16 tests, you really don't have a weapon. You've got a, you know, you've got something that has a big back, but there's no weapon. There's nothing that can be effectively used against any country. So no one is really scared of a big back, frankly. They're worried if you weaponize your big back. And that weaponization takes time. It takes a lot of effort. And at that point in time, computers are not strong enough. We could have gone in for that on the principle that if you're a strong country, you show your strength, ultimately people come to you and people respect you. Unfortunately, we took the point that we should not provoke people. We should, for whatever the reasons, 1974 test was not followed up, and as a result, we lost a huge opportunity, not only to weaponize, but also, in my point of view, to make this country a much more significant and serious player in world affairs. I was tracking the data about exports of Indian machinery in 75, 76, 77, 78. I found a quantum jump from around 75 onwards of Indian machinery. Very low base, I must confess, some machine tools, some other machine. In my view, this is because a lot of people realize that if you can produce a bomb, I mean, you can produce a blast, a nuclear blast, you are technologically sophisticated, and you trust machinery from that source. When you have, now China has gone to a space docking mission. Now people are going to, why are they going for space docking? Because they are moving up the value chain and they are wanting to go in for high technology exports. Who is going to buy a high technology export from a country unless you have confidence in that country? Now once you see the space docking on television, you know that you can trust China for high technology. It's the best marketing tool you've got for high technology exports. So you can say that you've wasted billions of dollars of that docking, but you're going to get hundreds of billions of dollars in higher high technology exports, and that is the Chinese way. Now, in our case, Pokhran could have been followed up with that kind of an export push, with that kind of a development of other things, even development of defense exports that have taken place, which today is almost zero. It was not followed up. 1973, oil shock, as I told you, huge amount of money for the oil countries. We did not take advantage of that money for the simple reason that we did not really have a policy towards the Middle East. Now, all this has had an impact on us as well, because, again, we were friendless. Now, as I said, as a journalist, I saw this at first hand, for example, 1980s, when I used to go to Punjab very frequently to cover the Khalistan problem, this Khalistan struggle. Internationally, the Americans were supporting the Khalistanis in a sense. They were active in Toronto, they were active in Vancouver, they were active in San Francisco, they were active in Chicago, they were active in New York. I used to go to, I mean, if you go to New York, you'll find them openly collecting money. You'll find them giving newspaper advertisements, give money, so that, you know, we can get our independent homeland there. And we could do nothing about it. The Indian mission could do nothing about it. We were completely, in a sense, helpless. The entire Western world was turning a blind eye to this activity inside India. Activity which was sponsored, funded by our neighbor Pakistan. Pakistan, of course, very friendly to the US, and that could be part of the reason. Pakistan was very friendly to Saudi Arabia, that could be part of the reason. Whatever it is, we got zero help from the United States and from the Western countries in tackling this problem. Zero. Zero help in Kashmir also. Not only did we get zero help, but we got a lot of pressure to make concessions in Kashmir and in fact to get away, give away Kashmir completely. Fortunately, that kind of pressure was not there that, you know, you create a Khalistan state. But definitely in the case of Kashmir, there was an immense pressure from America, immense pressure from the European countries that we abandon Kashmir to Pakistan. So in that sense also, our clumsiness, if I may say so, in diplomacy had a severe impact in the sense these two major insurgencies we faced alone. And I'm happy to tell this audience that with extreme courage, you faced it alone. In the case of the Khalistan insurgency, one great asset we had was the people of Punjab. I have gone to Khalistan many times. I've gone several times when Mr. K.P.S. Gill was the Director General of Police there. I remember the first decision he took as DGP was, previous to that, the DGP never used to have Sikh officers around him as his personal bodyguard. Mr. Gill said, I'm going to have only Sikh officers as my bodyguard. Not one officer around my bodyguard is going to be anybody other than someone who wears a turban who is Sikh. I mean, I was, you know, at that point in time, I was fortunate enough to be there at that point in time. And a lot of people thought this guy is setting himself up to put a bullet in the head or something. Nothing happened. He did it. He had, why? Because the people there, fundamentally, they remain loyal to this country, loyal to the tricolor, as they have remained loyal all their lives, and they have given their lives all their lives. That sterling spirit of the people of that state came to the fore during that struggle. And that is a very helpful factor in administration. In the case of Kashmir, of course, the local Sunni Kashmiri, I mean, abandoning struggle came a little later. But in the case of Punjab, we had this immense asset that the people of that state stood with India as they stood with India ever since, and as people of other regions and states have stood with India. But there was no external help whatsoever. On the contrary, the external help was to the separatist Khalistani movement and not to us who were fighting that movement. So let's go back now. I mean, as I said, I'm sorry that this is going to be a slightly depressing talk, but I would like to again remind you that depressing or not, we are now in terms of purchasing power parity, the fourth largest economy in the world, and we are going to be in terms of any parity, any reckoning, the third largest economy in the world in about 20 years time maximum, probably 27 years if we completely fall up in policies the way we are falling up now. And in much less time, if we don't follow up a policy, we have a fairly sensible policy, in 12 to 13 years time, we're going to become the third biggest economy in the world. And over time, in this century, we're going to become the biggest economy in the world. Any study of any country, of any intelligence unit has confirmed. So I would like to just give this quote a little bit. What I'm talking is the past, to some extent the present, is definitely not the future. So while you guys have a problem, your children don't have a problem. And your grandchildren have no problem at all. You know, it's only you guys that have a problem. And I mean, you know, tough luck for you. But now let's go back to 1992-97. And I say, is the age in which realism came. You had a Prime Minister, B.V. Narasimha. In fact, he should have been given a lot more credit than he was given. Even when the man passed away in 2004, his body was not allowed to enter the Congress office. It was kept on the pavement outside, not even the pavement, kept on the roadside, and was sent to Hyderabad rather than cremated in Delhi with that, you know, all those various beautiful things that you see in Delhi for all the other leaders. He should have got a lot more credit than he has, because on Kashmir, he withstood American pressure. In the Punjab, K.P.S. Gill and others were given strong backing by him, and I would, you know, a very strong backing to the people of the Punjab and who withstanding that. And the reason for that was, he adopted a policy of realism. He made it very clear, Soviet Union is gone. With the end of the Soviet Union, the end of our tilt to the Soviet Union also vanished. Of course, it did not vanish before we made one more useless sacrifice, and that is the India-Russia ruble-rupee deal. We lost about $14 billion in having an artificially high rate for the ruble vis-a-vis the rupee. No other country in the world had that rate. The argument was, the Russians will stop giving military spares to us if we don't have that rate. They did not stop giving military spares to any of the about 47 countries that they've been giving military spares to, and we would not have been the one country that they stopped, and 46 countries they continued. Because so long as you pay hard cash, the Russians will give you whatever spares you need. It's a very simple thing, you pay cash, you get the spares. So essentially, and then we want better relations with Russia. We did not get better relations with Russia. Boris Yeltsin was very negative on India for simple reason that even Mr. Gorbachev was negative on India, because when the coup against Mr. Gorbachev took place, the only country that sent a congratulatory message to the new so-called coup members who were in office for exactly 2 days was India. The only ambassador who called on the new chief, I forget the guy's name, I mean, I don't know, he's such an insignificant character that I don't even know his name. But I think for a few days he was the coup master, he was in the Kremlin. The Indian ambassador went and paid respects to him. The only country in the world was us. So for certain reason, Mr. Yeltsin didn't like us. It should have been obvious to us that Mr. Yeltsin didn't like us. We're not going to get a good deal no matter how much we sacrifice. But we sacrificed $14 billion in that Google movie deal. So we ended this era with one final burst of, if I may say so, innocence, sacrifice, whatever it is, I mean, that you're calling it. But anyway, it was done by the end of Mr. Narasimha Rao's government. It was done when Manmohan Singh was the finance minister. He's the one who signed it. And I'm really surprised that Rao and Manmohan Singh went ahead with this. I suspect, very frankly, although I've gone to Washington many times, I've talked to very many people, I haven't got access to confidential data there. I suspect there was US pressure on us to do it. Because the US was very interested in helping Russia at that point in time. The US was very interested in helping Yeltsin. And if you have a country which is stupid enough to give $14 billion, why not? So I suspect that there was some US pressure behind that decision. Otherwise, I really don't see why Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh went ahead with that kind of decision. Anyway, we had less pressure on Kashmir for the simple reason that Rao was friendly to the US in a way. Now that USSR had gone, there's nothing to be friendly towards. So by reflex, we jumped onto the US bandwagon or tried to jump onto that. Israel is a very important country from the US point of view. We normalized ties with Israel. We established diplomatic ties with Israel in 93, if I remember, 94. We established the normal relationship with Taiwan, which every other country has got, United States has got, European Union has got, some kind of a representational office. Till that time, we didn't have it. And Taiwan is a very important location in terms of economics. It's got double the foreign policy assets that we have, for example. It's got double the foreign trade we have, even though it's a very small island. So these were steps the United States was very pleased about. And of course, we had the Gujral Doctrine. Now, I know Mr. Gujral reasonably well. I think he's a remarkable man, and that was a great doctrine. But at that time I told him, and I can repeat it now, I told Mr. Gujral, this is a great doctrine, but please have one exception to this doctrine, that is Pakistan. Please don't give any concession to the Pakistan army. Because my thesis has always been, you give concession to Pakistan civil society, give concession to Pakistan businessmen, you play the business card, but give zero concession to the Pakistan army. Any so-called settlement in Kashmir, boundary, border, visas, all that are concessions to the Pakistan army, and we should have a policy of. So the Gujral Doctrine should have been implemented with one caveat, that it would not apply to Pakistan. Unfortunately, Mr. Gujral did not listen to any of us. He tried to introduce it to Pakistan also. It didn't have very much effect. And because of that lack of effect, it kind of diluted the positive impact it had in other countries. It was a very good doctrine, and it was also a doctrine which the United States was very happy about. So, as I said, and then during that time, we went and made an approach to the People's Republic of China. Now, the Chinese are great practitioners of realpolitik. They are very cold-blooded practitioners of realpolitik. If you recall, in the Mao Zedong, it was Mao Zedong who invited Nixon to come to China. It was Mao Zedong who basically put his imprimatur on the US-China relationship. And the reason for that was both had a common enemy, the Soviet Union. So because of that, they realistically came together and they decided to come together to fight the Soviet Union, and China got immense benefits from the United States. The entire growth of China is because of the United States. I mean, but for the United States, China would not have grown the way it has grown in the 1980s and 1990s. Of course, today it's become even too big even for the US, but for at least 20 years, its growth was because of the US. We were not really having a good policy, enough of an outreach to China. We started an outreach to China. We started a very strong outreach to the United States. And as a consequence, the pressure on us in issues like Kashmir became substantially moderated by the end of that decade. Of course,